Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 13th meeting of the Equalities and Human Rights Committee for 2019. Can I ask that everyone ensures their mobile devices are switched off and put away, please? This morning we have apologies from Mary Fee, and I welcome Rhoda Grant, who's substituting for her. And we also have apologies from Alex Cole-Hamilton for the first part of the meeting. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. Agenda item three, are members agreed? Agenda item two is considering the work of the Scottish Human Rights Commission and the Equality and Human Rights Commission. Can I welcome Judith Robertson, who's the Chair, and Kavita Chetty, who's Head of Strategy and Legal at the Scottish Human Rights Commission. You're both very welcome. Can I invite you to make a statement of up to 5 minutes, please?
Thank you very much. I'll do that. I just want to say, first of all, thank you for the invitation to be here. We really appreciate the Parliament and this committee spending time understanding the work of the Commission. We are Scotland's national human rights institution. We are an A-status organisation, which means that the way we work and the law that governs our work comply with a set of guidelines called the Paris Principles. We are a body of the UN and a recommendation by the UN that nation-states have a responsibility to ensure that human rights are progressed within the country, and the establishment of national human rights institutions were really designed to do that. We have a foundation in national law, as you're aware, our legislation. We are independent of government. We have a mandate to cover a broad range of international human rights standards. We need to develop, to demonstrate pluralism, I find it hard to say that word, and independence in the selection and appointment of our members. And we have a responsibility to work with both civil society and the state. We need to have adequate resources to function well, and we need to have adequate powers of investigation. These are the standards that the UN has established as being the principles against which we have to function, and those are the standards which we are deemed to have met in order to give us A-status. A-status entitles us to speak at the Human Rights Council and to represent the human rights landscape in Scotland to the bodies in the UN. We are the only Scottish organisation that can make direct contributions to the Human Rights Council on issues affecting people here. So we act as a bridge between human rights in Scotland and the international human rights system, and we monitor the implementation of international human rights treaties as they apply in Scotland, and working closely with civil society and others to gather evidence and produce recommendations for change. Our mandate is a general mandate. We have a general duty to promote awareness, understanding and respect for human rights, all human rights for everyone in Scotland. That would be economic, social, cultural, civil and political rights, and to encourage best practice in relation to human rights. We also have powers, I'll talk very briefly about them, then we can go into that just so you know. We have additional powers to conduct inquiries, enter some places of detention in the context of an inquiry, and intervene in civil court cases. That's the general duties of the Commission. Today, we are 10 years old, not today, but this year, or last year, we were 10 years old. We've been functioning really since 2008 and operating to deliver that mandate and build a culture of human rights in Scotland in partnership with a range of organisations. We've seen over that time a real development of the landscape in Scotland in relation to human rights. Outputs from that would be a much increased level of debate, which includes and involves human rights, much better understanding of human rights themselves in some settings, and then specifically state commitments from the First Minister to make significant progress in relation to the incorporation of human rights into domestic legislation in Scotland. That would include the commitment to incorporate the Convention on the Rights of the Child, fully incorporate the Convention on the Rights of the Child, and then a commitment to take forward a task force to deliver on the recommendations of the First Minister's Advisory Group on Human Rights Leadership. And the second aspect of that context, which I would consider to be very favourable for human rights, there's a lot more to come, but just to highlight, is that of the parliamentary inquiry, this committee's inquiry into how the Scottish Parliament could show could show more human rights leadership and bring evidence of itself as a human rights guarantor. That inquiry was full, extensive, really covered the bases in terms of how to progress that within Parliament. From our perspective, that is evidence of a significant, that's part of the picture of evidence of significant progress. So there's a very strong context in Scotland that we will be talking further about as we go ahead. But I also want to highlight some of the surrounding contexts which are not so positive. That would be the implications of Brexit, both in terms of the actual rights that would be lost, but more concerningly, the potential impact in relation to people's livelihoods, people's lives, the economic status of the country, and the potential reduction in the enjoyment of people's rights in relation to that. The wider international narrative about human rights has been in recent years often negative. That threatens the human rights framework and the capacity of or the willingness of countries to support the rule of law. We have seen that decline in some settings internationally, and again that threatens the compliance with international human rights standards. More importantly, obviously, people's lives and how they are able to live them. So. And the other thing I would highlight in Scotland, which I think does threaten people's rights, is our relationship to accountability. In some settings, we have a strong and positive relationship to accountability, but in other settings, we seek to weaken it, and we undermine it potentially, not by not resourcing accountability processes well enough, not understanding that actually delivering robust accountability processes actually enhances people's capacity to achieve their rights, and so there's a job of work to do to support people to understand that actually effective and positive accountability mechanisms help us all. So I think that's have I exceeded my time?
I think you're perfectly on time.
Okay.
There. Can I start by asking you about your strategic plan, please? How are you prioritising the aims in it, and probably more importantly, how are you going to measure outcomes and success?
Great. We're going through. We're currently actually developing our new strategic plan. This current plan finishes. This is the last year of the current plan, and we're currently undergoing. We've developed draft strategic priorities, and we are currently about to consult on those priorities. They're published today, actually. So we will briefly talk you through where we're at with that and how we will go take that forward. There's an extensive process of consultation. We've done internal consultation and internal conversation, really, to look at the environment. I'm really talking about the process of developing those draft strategic priorities. Clearly looking at the Paris principles to determine what is our role in relation to progressing rights in Scotland, and in the context in Scotland, how should we use our resources to best enhance what's happening, and therefore a range of strategic decisions will be made, and the committee's, I think the chair has been invited to contribute to some of that process around supporting us develop those strategic priorities. I'll go into detail of them. Yeah, you go.
We launch our strategic plan for 2020 to 2024 today to coincide with this evidence to the committee. As Judith said, we've really tried to ground our priorities in the current context that we see and what we see as the emerging challenges in the coming period. We think there are many challenges, as Judith already highlighted, economic, environmental, technological, constitutional, that will arise in that period of 2020 to 2024. And we think that human rights really needs to play a role in anchoring us through those uncertain and challenging times. So we're very much trying to respond to what we see as those challenges coming in that period. So as a result, we've got four emerging strategic priorities. The first is around economic, social and cultural rights, and progressing our understanding and strengthening of those rights in law. And in the next 4 years, we would like to see that taken forward. We see potential through the implementation of the First Minister's Advisory Group recommendations to take this forward. However, even without that, we think that these rights are a priority for us here in Scotland. It's what we hear from our stakeholders when we talk to them in consultation. And we think that with the loss of protections from Brexit, any potential impact of that, that putting economic, social and cultural rights into the law in Scotland can help us again in anchoring devolved power in Scotland through navigating those challenges. The second strategic priority that we see is strengthening accountability for meeting human rights obligations, and Judith's already talked to the challenges we see around accountability and our understanding of accountability as a full spectrum of things, from the conversations that people have in everyday settings, be that healthcare settings, social care settings, through to judicial enforcement of rights, and then everything in between, including scrutiny here in this Parliament. So we would like to see that taken forward, working with accountability bodies across the country to embed human rights into their processes.
When you talk about an accountability body, what do you mean by that?
So, for example, we've worked over recent years with HMIPS, the Prison Inspectorate. We've worked with the Care Inspectorate on their standards. We are in conversations with Audit Scotland about how they embed human rights. We have ongoing conversations with the Public Services Ombudsman. So these types of accountability mechanisms, we'll have a new Social Security Commission, a Poverty and Inequality Commission. So how do these accountability bodies across Scotland use the human rights framework to enhance the work that they do? Our third strategic priority is around building wider ownership of human rights. We think that there's a real opportunity to do that, and it's an essential part of the human rights culture in Scotland. Research that we released last year, conducted by YouGov, showed that there is considerable support for human rights in Scotland, slightly more favourable than south of the border, but nevertheless there's a swathe of people who are conflicted about rights, but we know that when provided with accurate information around rights and understanding, they're persuadable to be supportive of human rights, so we can have a rights respecting Scotland. So we would like to build on that research, communicate about rights effectively to rights holders, reaching them with the messages that we know are important to make them supporters of rights for everybody. And then the fourth strategic priority is around us showing global leadership in human rights as a national human rights institution. We are very small compared to our sister NHRIs around the world, of which we're one of around 100. But we really do seek to look to international best practice and emerging international standards and how we can use that in Scotland. So, for example, historically, we've looked at how the sustainable development goals and commitment to those sustainable development goals can be used in concert with human rights protections to advance rights protection in Scotland. That's seen as international best practice, and as a national human rights institution, we've sought to learn from others and bring that into Scotland. So we want to seek to continue to have be that bridge between international emerging best practice in human rights and Scotland. So there are four strategic priorities that are launched today. As Judith said, further to much more consultation, and we'd welcome views of this committee in terms of those emerging strategic priorities. And then we have further work to do to consider how we implement them in practice in accordance with our resources.
I suppose the second bit of my question was about measuring success. And when you talk about ownership of human rights, I think it's part of it's making it real for people. And I guess the accountability bodies that you mentioned, if people are achieving their rights through them, it's something that makes it real for our constituents. How will you measure success on these things?
We do this structurally through a range of means. We actually look at the outcomes we're seeking to achieve under all these strategic priorities. So these are our sort of strategic. The final version of them will represent what the Commission is seeking to do in Scotland. And then under that, we'll identify sort of key outcomes that we want to get to in relation to that. Then we actually start to pick up, well, how do we do that? So, for example, if I can just use the example of the Audit Scotland conversation, we're very much in conversation with them around this. But, for example, An indicator of success in working with Audit Scotland would be that some of their audits, in the first instance, start to bring human rights standards into the conversation and the dialogue that they have with public authorities in Scotland. We can track that. They will make that explicit. That's one of our success indicators, that they will make that explicit and that the questions they ask of public authorities in Scotland start to draw out from those organisations, how are we meeting these human rights standards? And so for us, that enables an organisation like Audit Scotland, which has reach into public authorities across Scotland, to actually bring them on board in a way that we simply would never, to be honest, have the resources to do so. That's quite a sort of strategic approach from our perspective. And our measurement of that is really to track those, to see the explicit evidence of that as we go forward. That's one route. The other side of that is say, well, what difference does that make? So that's we've had some impact. The conversation has increased. Audit Scotland have taken that forward. But then what impact does that have to people on the ground in communities? In honesty, that's a much harder thing to assess. I'm trying to think of another example where we would be able to track that change. I think in terms of the standards, for example, and we can come back to this if that's helpful, in relation to social care, the health and social care standards, the Commission has worked with the Care Inspectorate and Health Improvement Scotland to really transform the health and social care standards as they are currently framed in Scotland. And the new version was, I think, was launched last year. And that's completely turned around the way the Care Inspectorate is asking questions of bodies in social care settings, in health settings, around, well, how am I experiencing the care I am receiving? Not, here's the standard the Care Inspectorate expects, but how does that impact on the individual's experience of that care, whether it be healthcare, social care, whatever? From our perspective, that's really turned the relationship to a standards approach, an accountability mechanism, on its head and put people, human beings, at the heart of it. So it's not about the standards we expect, it's about what does that feel like for the person, and that's what's being measured. So over time, we'll be able to see, well, what difference does that make in terms of asking the question differently and having different expectations of what good looks like? So that's a sort of, I'm trying to give you examples to highlight our processes.
That's helpful, thank you. Gail Ross.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, both. Thanks for coming in. You did mention a couple of human rights issues that we're facing right now in Scotland, Brexit being one of them. Do you see a rolling back at all of human rights standards if we leave the European Union?
Yeah, so Brexit-related law reform and the securing of a renegotiated relationship with the EU and the positioning of our political leaders and parties at both the UK and the devolved level, I think have the potential to have a profound impact and long-lasting impact on our human rights laws and indeed our human rights culture. And the Commission stands by its position that any changes to our laws in relation to our rights really need to progress forwards and not regress back in the coming years to build a stronger society. And to guide us in that sort of forwards journey, we have some key principles. We want to see non-regression of standards for protected rights. We want to see measures taken that enable us to keep pace with progressive developments both across the EU and globally. And we really want to see Scotland lead the way in advancing the international collective commitment to human rights. So we are concerned that, of course, the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights will no longer directly apply in the UK or in Scotland as a consequence of the EU Withdrawal Act. I think it is notable and of concern that it was the Charter that's really singled out as the only aspect of EU law not to be retained as part of domestic law upon withdrawal from the EU. And that does indeed result in a substantive loss of protections in the immediate, and it also results in a loss of evolving protections over over time, as well as remedies for all areas that previously fell in the scope of EU law, like privacy, data protection, a fair hearing. And also without the Charter, there's that loss of potential for fuller protection of the social rights or principles, workers' rights, access to social security, healthcare, etc., as that might evolve over time. And even where current standards beyond the Charter, which have been transposed into domestic law, discrimination law, environmental protections, consumer rights, wider social protection, have been replicated, they do remain vulnerable to future repeal or regression. And there's no guarantee they will keep pace with any sort of progressive developments that are made at an EU level. And that concern about regression or diminution of rights is exacerbated, if you like, by these so-called Henry VIII powers, which allow ministers to manage legislative change to retain EU law by statutory instrument. And there's no other mechanism through which to protect retained rights from amendment over time. We welcome the attempt through the EU continuity legislation here to retain the Charter, but as you all know, the Supreme Court found aspects of the Continuity Bill, including the retention of the general principles of EU law and the Charter, to be outside the legislative competence of the Parliament. But in any effect, that would have been relatively limited, of course, in that it would only apply as far as devolved, retained EU law is concerned, and where Scottish authorities deemed to be implementing that devolved, retained EU law. And so for current standards of rights to be maintained, Westminster Parliament would have to take those similar steps. But we think that move was very much in line with where Scotland is at. It's in line with this Scotland Declaration on Human Rights, which was a declaration signed by over 150 civil society organisations and others, that expressed really united support that Scotland should be a leader in human rights protection and implementation as we embark upon our journey on leaving the European Union.
So is this going to have any effect on the priorities in your strategic plan that you laid out?
It does, as I think we've said earlier. In particular, we are interested in the implementation of the recommendations of the First Minister's Advisory Group on Human Rights Leadership. Recommendation of one of which is there should be an act of Scottish Parliament to provide leadership and a new framework of rights to improve people's lives. Now, clearly, this doesn't fully mitigate the loss of protections through the Charter or broader EU law. It certainly doesn't do that. However, it does advance our human rights protections. We were pleased that the First Minister expressed that she shared the ambition of the group for the recommendations towards that act of the Scottish Parliament, but we do now have concerns that there's no concrete steps being taken, no announcement has been made in relation to the advancement of an implementation of those recommendations.
In one of your priorities, it was building wider ownership of human rights. How do you plan to do that?
Oh, that's quite a big question. To be honest,
how can we help you?
I can come on to that. Actually, the inquiry and the recommendations in the inquiry will absolutely enable building the wider ownership of rights. The Commission has the intention of continuing to support the Parliament and this committee in ensuring those recommendations are delivered to the best effect as we can do. And we can talk a bit about that, about the detail of that. So the Parliament absolutely has a role. The more explicit this Parliament makes human rights in their conversations, in their scrutiny, in their legislative processes, in their engagement with all the organisations you engage with across the piece, not just in this committee, but right across the committee structure, the stronger will the public ownership of human rights be. You have a unique and significant role in providing leadership in relation to that. And we see our role as supporting you to the best we can within the resources that we have, and I will talk about that later, hopefully. To do that to best effect, and how we do that, I can come back to. In effect, all that we do has the capacity to build that public ownership of rights. But specifically, we also recognise that in order to reach rights holders who are not necessarily the people who will engage with this parliament or who will be out in community settings or the people that walk into your surgeries on a day-to-day basis whose rights are being infringed by whatever process that they're encountering. They're harder to bring on board to be part of that public ownership. So we have been developing in the last number of years means of communicating with people which people can better access. So things like videos of explaining what people's rights are. We're just about to embark on one looking at the right to food, helping people really understand what the right to food means, what their rights are, some of the implications of how that's being delivered or not being delivered in Scotland today, and really talking into communities and engaging with people in communities to say, what does this feel like? But B, if you have these rights, how can they be better realised? Which brings me to that accountability gap, because we have a problem with accountability, because we can raise awareness of people's rights, but if they have no means of actually gaining access to their rights or holding people to account for the lack of delivery against those rights, then that's why that's our second strategic priority, because we need to support our public authorities and institutions in Scotland to recognise that their responsibilities in relation to rights are real. And that maybe we need to be thinking about how we prioritise our resource allocation, the way we're really looking at the right at people's rights and how they're best being delivered in communities. So that public ownership is quite broad. It will happen through, I would say, to be honest, all our activities, but we will have some specific targeted activities which will be intended to meet to touch into people for whom that's a much harder conversation to access, if that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely. Great. Thank you. Oliver, I think you had a supplementary.
Thank you. I was interested just in the comments around Brexit, and I just wondered, I do hear the points that you're making, but I wonder whether, you know, it is in fact a prerequisite of leaving the EU that human rights would be eroded, because, I mean, I'd certainly recognise that there are significant domestic and international protections that remain in place, and there's no reason to suppose that human rights law wouldn't continue to develop and be enhanced as it has done prior to the United Kingdom joining the EU. There'd be no reason to think that wouldn't continue.
Yep, thank you for your question. So firstly, no, we do have concerns about that loss of the Charter and the broader EU protections and as they evolve over time. But also further to that, we still have deep concerns about the position of the Human Rights Act 1998 and our relationship to the European Convention of Human Rights and indeed the Council of Europe. So in recent correspondence between the EU Justice Subcommittee and the current government, the stated position was that the UK has no plans to withdraw from the ECHR. However, that's really, to some degree, an insufficient reassurance in this regard, because it leaves open still the possibility of weakening accountability for human rights through changes to the Human Rights Act. The chairwoman of that committee noted that the government, you know, still won't give assurances that it won't repeal or reform the Human Rights Act, which essentially incorporates the ECHR into our domestic law. And we know that it's been the previous intention of the Westminster government to do so. And historically, the various proposals that we've seen and the ideas that we've had mooted around the future of the Human Rights Act and our relationship to the ECHR have been troublesome, in that they talk about limiting the application of the convention, reducing its extraterritorial effect, and diminishing the role of the Strasbourg court and making judgments advisory only. And our view as a commission really is that this undermines the collective enforcement of human rights across Europe and really puts us in a collision course with Strasbourg, where, as part of the convention, it states that states need to abide by the final judgments of the court. So the Commission's position, obviously, is that we need to maintain in full, as you say, the protections that are provided for in the Human Rights Act that we currently have embedded in the Scotland Act and in devolution. But we think there's probably no room for complacency there going forward. So progress notwithstanding, we still have concerns. Also, that EU membership, to some degree, and the application of the Charter have acted as a deterrent to withdrawal from the ECHR to some degree. And so that notion of stepping back from the ECHR and accountability is still deeply concerning, as it's, you know, it is one of the most effective regional protection mechanisms for human rights globally. So we still have concerns about the existing protections that we have, as well as the loss of other protections as a result of Brexit.
I just to add to that, I think it's also worth saying or worth recognising. I was in Geneva a number of weeks ago with the Global Alliance of National Human Rights Institutions, but we met there with the UN ambassador, the UK ambassador to the UN mission, who was saying that actually they were seeking to increase their profile within the UN and double the size of the embassy there, and that in itself does give some assurance that Britain's commitment to the international human rights system is seen as important and valuable. So that was a reassurance. However, all that Kavita says absolutely applies in terms of the loss of protections and the backstop that the EU membership provides in terms of our ongoing membership of the Council of Europe and commitment to the European Convention.
Okay, and just in relation to the further points, you know, is it not the case that the right to with withdrawal from international organisations and to reform your relationship with them is the democratic right of a sovereign state, and that these things are not particularly unusual?
So, firstly, in 47 nations and 800 million people are within the European human rights system, which arose out of a situation post-war where it was recognised that there was a need for collective enforcement of human rights internationally. No democracy has ever withdrawn from the convention. While I recognise that, of course, it is every state's right to do so, but the convention, from our perspective, has protected a whole raft of progressive things in this country, from ending corporal punishment in schools, protected our privacy against intrusion, protected our right to protest, put in place protections in mental health detention settings, and created positive obligations to safeguard people from harm and protect their right to life. The Human Rights Act through the Scotland Act also had significant impact in the Scottish courts and in case law, as well as the broader culture of human rights in Scotland. And so the impact of that, of the Human Rights Act and our adherence to the convention, has been felt by people in so many settings, sectors and spheres, from prisons and police custody to the media and safeguards on personal data, etc. So while that is within the gift of any state to do so, we would say that would be an absolutely regressive step, both for the citizens of the country, but also more globally. It would send a truly damaging message across Europe and globally for the UK to in any way withdraw from the supranational protection of human rights. And really, the Commission's heartened that there's no appetite or little appetite for this in Scotland, as we saw when the debate around the Human Rights Act happened and through the Scotland Declaration, etc. And generally, we are pleased that it's been welcomed that human rights compliance is really built into the fabric of devolution in Scotland through the Scotland Act. So we want to see that secured and we want to see that progressed.
Annie Wells.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. Earlier on, in one of the answers, we spoke about success and how it gets measured. So my question is, what is the Commission's biggest success and how does it measure that success?
I would say we have a lot of successes, but thank you for the question. However, I would say our biggest success is progressing understanding of human rights and the need capacity for human rights protections in Scotland, to the extent where the First Minister established an advisory group to look at how better we could develop human rights leadership around filling that accountability gap in relation to protecting the rights, the economic and social and cultural rights, which remain unprotected in domestic law under the Human Rights Act. So the Human Rights Act only primarily protects civil and political rights, and so that gap, and if we talk to people in communities about their rights, the things they say first of all are their economic and the social rights. They care about health, housing and education, and then their income to support their general lives. These are economic and social rights, they're not civil and political rights. And so the things that people care about in Scotland, and I would argue across the UK, are the least protected in our domestic law. So from the Commission's perspective, that translation from the local setting to a response from the First Minister and from the government to say we want to protect those rights, that for me is a huge success. When I came to the Commission 3 years ago, but I was aware of it from its establishment, we would, in the 10 years ago when we started, there is no way that conversation would have taken place. We didn't understand incorporation. We didn't know what that meant, the notion that rights could be protected through domestic law. While the Human Rights Act was there and people were clear about that, and it was enshrined in obviously the Scotland Act, that the notion that economic and social cultural rights deserved the same protection was not. So I would say that shift from understanding both economic, social, cultural rights generally, and then turning that into something which is protected potentially in domestic law is a huge achievement. The Commission has played a major role in that. I also have to recognise that a number of other actors have engaged in that proactively, and that's been really important. And I would say that as another key success is our capacity to work with others, actually, because we would not have made any of the achievements, or many of them, without that capacity to work with others. And it's been a key part of our strategy since we started.
I might just talk briefly in sort of internal governance terms about how we measure success. So firstly, all of our sort of operational planning under our strategic plan has a strong outcomes focus. We work across 10 broad outcomes as an organisation, and every single project and activity has its own set of outcomes that we want to achieve, and where possible, key performance indicators of whether or not we've achieved it. We report to the Commission against those outcomes on a quarterly basis. Our measurement of that is really proportionate to our size and our function, and is tailored to the types of work that we're doing. In some instances, we'll have more substantial inbuilt sort of evaluation of our work. So, for example, we had University of Glasgow do an independent evaluation of SNAP, Scotland's National Action Plan for Human Rights, and we've had some our internal researcher do work on our housing project in Leith to assess that. So in some instances, we've got sort of what we would regard as relatively clear and measurable impacts. So for example, we gave evidence to the Committee for Parliamentary Reform. That led to this committee doing an inquiry into how the Parliament could be a human rights guarantor, which we hope will now lead to an implementation plan and progress. So difficult to measure in terms of the convener's original question, impact for individuals on the ground. But from our perspective, we wanted to see human rights embedded more systematically through the Parliament, more regard to international obligations and treaty body recommendations. And we are beginning to see that happening. Another example, social security legislation. We very much raised the profile and understanding of the right to social security with the government, with Parliament, with civil society, and through the passage of that legislation. And we think that our intervention contributed to enhanced accountability mechanisms. So, for example, the scrutiny body, which must exercise its functions in accordance with the right to social security as set out in international law. So we see that as an outcome of our intervention. Or our work around working with government to secure an explicit human rights outcome within the national performance framework. So we now have a human rights outcome which says that we want to respect, protect and fulfil rights and live free from discrimination within our national performance framework. So this adds to human rights being part of the fabric and governance of Scotland, and we see that as a direct result of our intervention. There are other places in our work where it's less measurable for us as an organisation, particularly relative to our size. So, for example, we provided quite extensive training in advocacy settings with the Scottish Independent Advocacy Alliance. And it was only when we were looking back at what our success measures were over a 10-year period that we were able to speak to advocates on the ground who had used that training and understanding, and they were able to talk to the direct experience about how that had helped the people that they support. And then there's that much broader picture, as Judith said, where we really do think the Commission's made a difference in terms of raising the profile of economic, social, cultural rights, understanding of incorporation, understanding of how we can strengthen our laws and put them into practice, which again is much less measurable. But I've been at the Commission for 10 years now, and if you go back 10 years, I know many of the debates that we have now we would not have been having 10 years ago.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks, Convener.
Okay. Fulton.
Thanks, Convener. And good morning, panel. You mentioned just in the last bit there about the Scottish National Action Plan. I was going to ask a wee bit about that. And outcome 8 in the annual report says that SNAP is achieving its medium-term outcomes. Are you able to expand a wee bit on that format and give us an update and how you're achieving that?
So one of the medium-term outcomes of the first iteration of SNAP was to strengthen the protections in domestic law around in relation to, or actually it was about Scotland fulfilling its international obligations in relation to human rights, and one of the reasons we've said that is achieving some of its medium-term outcomes is because of the commitments that have been made in relation to enhancing those protections, which were not there when SNAP started. So that's the indication of the progress that has been made. In terms of an update, we've hosted and facilitated a process. We're still in that process. A development working group made up of about 20 organisations and individuals who were, some of whom were part of the original iteration of SNAP and some new people engaging in that, to really drill down into what are the priority actions that and the next round of Scotland's National Action Plan can undertake. In the last year of the last action plan, we had a full participation process where we engaged with communities around Scotland to say, well, what are their priorities? There were some quite interesting outcomes of that process. Again, I would say most of them related to people's economic and social rights. But we identified 25 themes from that process. I will share with you all 25, and we've actually systematically been going through those themes to say, well, what are the priority actions that would best progress in relation to that from a human rights and human rights terms. It's not too big a task to do that work, but the need to prioritise down and then identify, well, what are the key actions we think are important in Scotland over the next period of the next iteration of SNAP. I would also say, however, that one of the key challenges of the first iteration of SNAP was the resources that were made available to make that as successful as it could be. I think we did achieve make significant progress, but the lack of a resource base, explicit resource base in relation to Scotland's National Action Plan is a real constraint. And unless resources are enabled to ensure that the next phase of SNAP goes forward, then we will not see the progress that is required in Scotland. There are a number of quite urgent areas of action, and there are clear priorities for activity that we've identified. And so we've come to the end of that analysis in relation to the key actions, and we will be doing some work to further prioritise, but we also I would also say we need clear engagement from the government in relation to actually developing that prioritisation and supporting the process going forward. That's not been as nearly. I'm not saying it's not been there. There has been engagement in government with the process, but it really needs to be extended right across government to actually see delivering a National Action Plan on human rights for Scotland is a priority. It's actually explicit in the first recommendations of the First Minister's Advisory Group. So it was very much integrated into that conversation, and delivering a new Act of Scottish Parliament in relation to economic social rights is a significant part from our perspective of what should be included in a National Action Plan going forward.
And see, when you said there that you engaged with a wide range of people across the country, did you notice, I suppose there's two parts to my question, I'll just join together. Did you notice a difference in different geographical areas and locations about what were priorities for people? And how did you, do you feel, Do you feel that you've reached out to communities that can sometimes be harder to engage in these issues?
So we covered cities and rural areas. We sought to go into the rural communities because they are in and of themselves find it harder to engage in sort of national processes just by dint of the distance. Although I know there are lots of endeavours to make that happen well across Scotland. So we were in Dumfries and Galloway, we were in Inverness, we were in Dundee, we were in different places, different locations to have those conversations. I would say we achieved limited success. We did achieve success in reaching out into some of the groups that would find it harder to engage. We have representatives from the Roma, the Gypsy Traveller community on our group, and for that as a community in and of itself, again, has got lots of historical discrimination stacked against it. And so their engagement is also really important. Yes, there was a difference in terms of people's analysis. There's no doubt about it. Rural areas are very differently impacted on by the delivery of public services in Scotland, and this Parliament is well aware of that. I think you've got good analysis and good understanding of that. But that came out again and again and again in terms of people's ability to actually, one of the top things that came out was transport, and the lack of I don't want to say a lack, because there's not a complete lack, the lack of transport, an effective and integrated transport system around rural areas in Scotland really impacts people's capacity to access the things which deliver on their rights. So that would be employment, health provision, education, etc., future education, further education access. So yes, there was a difference. Which wasn't, to be honest, much of a surprise. That analysis and understanding of the different geographical locations in Scotland, and then the different needs that different groups have, how they're met, how they're served, they came out. I would say that also we needed to do more to reach into other settings, Black and minority ethnic communities, and children and young people. So those were two areas where I think we have more to do. I would say, both as a commission and as a national action plan. We've got good engagement, particularly from the children and young people sector in the national action plan. And obviously they're very well organised and their understanding of rights is pretty strong. But still that engagement with children and young people is something that we also need to make sure happens.
Is that very robust and honest appraisal?
Okay, Oliver.
Thank you, convener. The annual report demonstrates that you've had a busy year. Will this be sustainable in the longer term, and what issue might there be in terms of resources, which I know you've already mentioned?
So let me talk about the resource base of the Commission. The resource base of the Commission has declined slightly in real terms over the 10 years of its existence. That's principally as a result of a 15% reduction in all public sector bodies about 4 or 5 years ago, before I'd started in the Commission. But over time, and the increases that any small increases we've had in our budget really have been to accommodate percentage salary increases, pay deals, etc., rather than any actual increase in the resource base of the Commission. I think when we first started, the budget that we have, which is just around £1 million, was sufficient to establish the organisation, set us up on a solid footing. And over the 10 years of our life, as you said, we're very busy. We cover a lot of areas, and that's been a very that's been a successful process. I actually think Scotland can be, and the Parliament indeed can be, proud of having a national human rights institution that has made such progress, or supported the country to make progress in relation to human rights. However, I also totally recognise now that 10 years on, the Commission needs to grow. We need to be able to respond to that increased demand, as understanding of human rights increases. As we succeed in delivering our mandate, so also does the demand on the organisation to respond. For example, the Parliament itself really is keen to see the capacity of MSPs grow in relation to engaging around human rights standards, international instruments, and monitoring, for example, the treaty body recommendations and how progress is made in that. We would expect the Commission to be fully engaged in that process. If we did that now, and we will endeavour to do as much as we can, that would seriously displace other activities that you know, we've been developing over the years. So, the positive side of that dynamic in terms of the context in Scotland being something that we really want to respond to well and be in a position as an organisation to do that has really come about as a result of the work of the last 10 years. The delivery of an Act of Scottish Parliament in relation to economic and social and cultural rights and environmental rights requires support in Scotland. If that is to be a good process and a process whereby at the end of the day, there is consensus. There's an understanding around the country of what is at stake and why that's an important outcome for the country to have. We would anticipate the Commission be fully engaged in that process of working to build capacity to understand and make sure that legislation is as strong as it can be. So those are the positive settings where we see real. There's opportunities for progress to be made, from our perspective. Really justify looking at the resource base of the Commission and growing it. The negative context is that of the potential reduction in rights in relation to Brexit, and the potential. I mean, we don't know how this is going to pan out, but the potential for a short, medium, don't know how long term economic impact as we leave the European Union. If that pans out in a negative way for communities and individuals around Scotland, then the need for rights protections and the need for a strong human rights institution which is able to effectively monitor, understand and report back to say this is the impact, whether it deems out as the impact of Brexit, but if there's a negative economic impact over time, we're able to actually see that and support understanding that human rights have a role to play in that. So there's a real, from our perspective, the time, we're developing a new strategic plan, the time to put a new resource proposal to the Parliament and to SPCB and then the Parliament, that's the time. The time is now, and we will be doing that, developing that proposal over the summer and making that submission to SPCB.
Just to get an idea, I know it's maybe unfair in the context of that to ask you, what do you envisage, you know, in general terms will be required? Is it, we talked before about the UN UK team increasing by, I think it was a third, is that the sort of, is it? Doubling, sorry.
Yeah, doubling.
Are you envisaging doubling in size?
I would envisaging or? Really celebrating if we were to double in size. I think I said yesterday to Sandra White, MSP, who's the office holder representative of SPCB, that we wouldn't necessarily expect to double, but expectation is a wonderful thing, and asking. The honest answer to your question is I don't know. We haven't. We're still in a process of both pinning down their strategic priorities and then looking at those strategic priorities. And if we're to deliver them really well in Scotland, what's it going to take in terms of the Commission's size and resourcing? We haven't fully answered that question. What I would say to you is as soon as we have, we will inform the committee and give you the same information as we will be giving to SPCB, if that's helpful to you. Just as an indicator also, because I talked about the UK mission at the UN, Northern Ireland, the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission, which is slightly bigger than us, they have 1.1 million, so when I say slightly, I mean slightly, they are also anticipating doubling in size over the next year in response to a range of things, but partly in response to Brexit. So I'm... I'm not expecting to double in size. I think that would be ambitious. Not because we couldn't absorb it. We absolutely could do that. But I think the financial realities are such that that would be challenging. However, should the Parliament decide that that was necessary, we would absolutely be, we genuinely would be in a position to provide a really positive programme in Scotland that would absolutely enhance people's rights. Another part of the conversation which we're aware of, obviously, is about our powers and the powers that we have as a national human rights institution. I don't know if you're going to come on to that.
Would our grants actually just going to come on to
okay,
that?
Okay,
right
I'll
now,
let you ask your question. Time. Good segue.
Sorry, have you got...
All right.
Okay, yeah.
It was just as well, just to be absolutely clear on the first answer, if you didn't see an increase in resources, you don't feel you'd be adequately able to do your job. Is that too far?
What we would have to do would be a version of the... Clearly, we have been operating, I would say, extremely effectively on the money we have. We will continue to operate effectively on the money we have. We will just have to cut our cloth to ensure that the job we do is doable for an organisation of our size. But it will mean that the resources we put into progressing some of these processes will just be reduced. I mean, we will absolutely function as well as we can within the resource that we're allocated.
Thank you.
Rhoda.
Moving on to powers. You said in your opening statement that you had power to intervene in civil proceedings. But at the last, well, the evidence session 2017, you said you hadn't used those powers. Have you used them since then?
Yep. Yes, you're right. We have the power with leave of the court to intervene in civil proceedings where it's relevant to our general duty and where it raises a matter of public interest. And to date, we haven't used those powers. However, we are imminently about to make an application to the court to intervene in proceedings against the private provider of asylum accommodation, Serco, in relation to its lock change policy to evict asylum seekers who are believed to no longer be entitled to asylum accommodation. So our first intervention is imminent. And we would like to increase the use of these powers and intervene in matters more going forward that are relevant to our strategic priorities and raise those matters of public interest. And we do consider that our legal powers are an important part of our mandate that give us the necessary teeth that we need to hold public bodies to account for our rights. And while we've not used them today, as I say, we're ambitious to use them in the future. I think it is worth reflecting on, as I think I might have in our last evidence session to the committee, that this Parliament's view of our powers when our legislation that set us up was first going through the Parliament, because from debates at the time, it was considered that our primary function was to support bodies to meet their human rights obligations and raise awareness of human rights in line with our general duty to promote awareness, understanding and respect for human rights and promote best practice. And the legal powers, to some degree, were sort of secondary to that primary purpose, but nevertheless, as I say, important to give us the teeth that we need. I think the fact that we've not used them probably slightly reflects the strategic positioning of the Commission over the last 10 years, and also its relatively limited resource pool in terms of staff, team and budget, and that needs to make as astute strategic choices as we can, as was referred to in the question by Oliver Mundell earlier. However, the Commission's always remained receptive to using its powers where issues are identified. And I think this current intervention that we're embarking on is quite instructive to us, both in terms of the impact that we can have and that we can make, and also in terms of internally for us, what resource base is really required in order to take forward interventions in civil litigation.
Okay. The getting it right, getting rights right? Inquiry talked about a review of your powers. I wonder if you agree that there should be a review, and if there was, what powers would you envisage that you would need? What further powers do you need?
Yeah. So undoubtedly, as I think has been alluded to earlier, we have less legal powers than comparative bodies and other national human rights institutions globally. And the report of the Joint Committee for Human Rights in 2018, enforcing human rights, sets out a helpful sort of summary table, if you like, of the powers that we have relative to our sister bodies, the Equality and Human Rights Commission and the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission. So, for example, we don't have the power to take judicial review or any other legal proceedings in our own name, and nor do we have the power to give assistance to individuals in relation to proceedings concerning the protection of human rights. So we welcome the recommendation of the committee, and we think in the future careful consideration needs to be given to extending the Commission's power that's commensurate with our resources and allowing us to fulfil the full breadth of our mandate, recognising the type of resource that is required to fulfil those types of functions. Also, our inquiry power is worth touching upon here also. It's far-reaching, but perhaps gives us less flexibility than analogous powers of other institutions. Our inquiry power allows us to look at public bodies of one nature. We can't look at, for example, one local authority. We would have to look at all local authorities or a public body that's providing a unique function. We have to set out terms of reference and our methodology, and all of our inquiries have to be conducted in public. Other institutions, for example, the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission has an investigation power, which allows them to conduct investigations however they see as expedient to do so. Here in Scotland, the Children and Young Persons Commissioner Scotland has both a general and individual investigation power, again allowing sort of further flexibility in terms of the scope and the subject matter of their investigation. So these and many other considerations will clearly have to be looked at carefully as the committee and ourselves undertake that work in the future and our powers are considered. But meanwhile, the Commission will continue to look for ways to exercise its existing powers while also fulfilling, as I say, the full breadth of our mandate.
Can I just, on that... obviously, there's powers versus resources, and we were talking earlier about the workload that is going to grow and the need for more resources. Would you have the resources if you had those powers? Would you need more resources to fulfil that? Because it seems to me that it could open up quite a number of investigations, especially with local government, because they have considerable powers to exercise at will. Which would be different from all councils. So I can imagine that there would be cases, just thinking about my own mailbag, really, where individuals would look at, or groups of people would look at the practice of one council and be looking maybe for support from yourselves.
So... yes, with regard to our inquiry power, we have, in fact, internally over the course of the last year led some relatively detailed scoping work as to the methodology and the resources and potential subject matters for use of our power. And we've also had direct and extensive engagement with the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission about their experience of conducting a public inquiry into accident and emergency services in Northern Ireland, and also their investigation into gypsy traveller accommodation, primarily to understand what resources it took from them to conduct that work. And I think it's fair to say that the resources to conduct that work were considerable. In relation to the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission inquiry into A&E, it absorbed almost all of their organisation for almost 2 years. So while the Scottish Human Rights Commission could make such a choice, it is clear that it would divert resources from the rest of our work. As I say, the Commission is actively has an interest in using the powers, and we're keeping that under review. We're continuing to try and hone our methodology in a way that's commensurate with the resources that we have and in a way that will still be meaningful and have impact. But certainly that is a challenge for the Commission, one that we are grappling with and one that we will take into consideration in our review of resources and structure.
And just to, in a more general sense, if our powers were to be enhanced or additional powers were given, we would absolutely require more resources to deliver against those powers effectively. That, I mean, that's the sort of underpinning message from Kavita's response. Because, for example, if we were to have the power to take our cases in our own name, the resources required to do that are significant. And even as we found in the resources in relation to making interventions in civil cases, actually we have very limited resource. It's not in terms of staff time potentially, but in terms of actual the costs of engaging counsel in those processes. So there are practical matters in relation to staff time, but then there are the financial resources to support that process. So yes, if we do welcome the prospect of reviewing our powers, absolutely, but we also recognise that doing that has got resource implications.
You've mentioned in your evidence the First Minister's advisory group and indeed this committee's report, so the recommendations from both those things are out there. Just to finish up, can I ask you what you think the next step should be in moving those recommendations forward?
Broadly, both of those processes require a clear action plan and a commitment to resource those action plans to deliver against the recommendations for both of them. Kavita's got some specifics, but for me, that's the next step. In both of those processes, see ourselves as active participants, and potentially both in developing those action plans as well as being involved in the delivery of them. So, yeah, we have a clear interest in seeing them progressed.
Specifically in relation to the First Minister's Advisory Group on Human Rights Leadership, recommendation 6 of that process outlined there should be a process of implementation with a national task force established. As I say, that national task force has yet to be announced, but we very much hope that announcement will be imminent, and we have concerns if it is not, and we would see ourselves as playing a role in terms of increasing understanding across all actors of the rights that we seek to enshrine in an act of the Scottish Parliament, in a broad public participatory process in that regard, and also in terms of the capacity building required for the implementation of such an act. Reiterate Judith's point in relation to the inquiry recommendations, the getting rights inquiry of this committee, we look forward to seeing an implementation plan to take that forward. We are committed in this operational plan year to work with officials in the Parliament to look at advancing a human rights-based approach to scrutiny and also human rights capacity building within the Scottish Parliament, and the Commission looks forward to working with the Parliament to do that imminently.
Well, that brings us to the end of this panel. Thank you both very much for your evidence. We'll suspend for 5 minutes to change witnesses. Thank you.
I'll try.
Welcome back, everyone, and can I welcome our second panel, Alistair Pringle, Executive Director, Lynn Welsh, Head of Legal for Scotland, and John Wilkes, Head of Scotland, Equality and Human Rights Commission. You're all very welcome. Can I invite an opening statement of up to 5 minutes, please?
Well, for that, thanks for the opportunity to share some of our highlights from 2018-19 and our priority aims for the year ahead. We've sent you some background documents which cover all the key points that I want to make. Including a bit of the background to our organisation being GB, etc. So I'm not going to go into that just now. I'd say this last year has been one of us of review of our organisation, refinement in the way that we operate, and a bit of a refocus on the work that we do, as set out in our soon-to-be-laid strategic plan, and we've sent you that plan on a page. On review, we went through our periodic tailored review, which is something that's undertaken on all arm's length bodies, and that highlighted a number of our successes and recognised many of the improvements that we've made over the last few years. But it also understandably identified some key areas for improvement, in particular how we prioritise, how we show the impact of our work, how we influence and engage with our stakeholders. The review also recommended that we were much clearer about the use of our unique powers and levers at our disposal. And that's a key theme that's also been picked up by the Westminster Women and Equalities Committee, who are currently undertaking an inquiry into the enforceability of the Equality Act and the role of the EHRC as the enforcement body. I'll say a little more about how all this impacts on our work going forward, but I first wanted to share some of the highlights from the year past. We launched Is Scotland Fairer 2018, our three-year review of progress on equality and human rights, a significant body of evidence and part of our Is Britain Fairer reporting. We concluded work on the Scottish City Deals, influencing and embedding equalities in the inclusive growth policy agenda in Scotland, and we've engaged and influenced all city regional deals and the Ayrshire Growth Deal over the last year. We've carried out research on the impact of Brexit into the benefits of EU funding, which has been delivered for equality in Scotland, and the need for future arrangements to continue to support equality. We undertook a major review into the effectiveness of the public sector equality duty. And that found that compliance with the specific duties is not having the desired effect in terms of driving change for people with protected characteristics. Evidence we will use to inform the forthcoming consultation on the specific duties. We completed our housing inquiry into the accessibility of homes for disabled people and have called on the Scottish Government to set a 10% target for accessible housing. And we've undertaken a growing number of successful compliance, enforcement and legal interventions. Looking forward, the breadth of our remit and the size and reduction in our budget mean that we need to make some really difficult choices about what we work on. We've based our priorities for the next 3 years of our new strategic plan on evidence of the most challenging equality and human rights issues facing society as set out in Is Britain Fairer and Is Scotland Fairer. We consulted widely on these priorities and had a great response from our Scottish stakeholders. Our priorities reflect our dual remit as a national equality body and as an A status NHRI. And, of course, respect the mandate of the SHRC in Scotland in terms of devolved areas of human rights. We have a close working relationship internationally and domestically with the SHRC, and that allows us to complement their human rights work where appropriate, for example, in our criminal justice inquiry. As you'll see from the plan on the page, we're now working to achieve change in five priority aims, which cover work, transport, education, access to justice and work on institutions. And we have a core overarching aim, which is that we ensure we maintain strong equality and human rights laws that protect people and that we have the data available to show what's happening to people in practice. Our main areas of focus here will be on safeguarding laws post-Brexit, seeking a strengthened and more impactful public sector duty, supporting work to incorporate UN treaty rights into Scots law, and influencing the collection of data across our aims on protected characteristics to ensure we can measure progress. We're happy to share more about the specific work we we plan in any of these areas. But I just want to finish briefly on how we'll work, and you will see in our plans an increased focus on compliance and enforcement. A key plank of our new strategic plan is legal support projects, taking multiple cases on particular areas of life aligned to our aims. And this is to create a critical mass, which makes it clear that areas of life are regulated space. We've created new compliance and enforcement teams, and that's seen increased staffing in Scotland. Lynn will be able to tell you a bit more about that. And we've increased our investigations and inquiry work. We're currently running two inquiries with more in the pipeline, where previously we would only run one every few years. But I would also defend the importance of the full range of our powers and levers. We're part of the architecture for equality that goes beyond legal enforcement and litigation. Many of the root causes require other types of activity. For example, encouraging good practice or providing evidence, such as is Scotland Fairer. We're clear we need to focus on prevention as well as cure. Thank you.
Thank you for that. You mentioned in your opening statement there that improving how you prioritise your aims was an area that you were working on. Can I ask you to expand on that a bit, how you're going to go about doing that?
As I said in my kind of opening narrative, the challenge I think for many is being clear on the work that we do as an organisation. Is Scotland Fair evidence provided us with some of the key areas of significant inequality in Scotland, and we've used that as the backdrop for our engagement with stakeholders. I wonder if John might want to say a bit more about the work that we've done engaging on Is Scotland Fair?
Yes, sure. We produced the report in later part of last year, but in the run-up, it's a report that built on the 2015 report. The whole process of developing the report and gathering evidence takes a couple of years. And in terms of the Is Scotland Fairer, we obviously feed into the Is Britain Fairer report where that's appropriate. We obviously mine the relevant data sources. We work with loads of stakeholders in terms of other sources and impressions that people have. When we had the first cut of the evidence, we had a series of roundtables in Scotland with key stakeholders from those particular areas around education and work and participation, to check out that the test out that the evidence met with their experience, and that was very helpful in producing the final report. I think what we would say in terms of Is Scotland Fairer 2018 compared to 2015 is that progress overall, we were looking at very similar things that we've looked at in 2015, has been slow overall, and very little areas where there's been improvement. And
thank you. So we started with an evidence base, and then the next step for us was really looking at the areas of work we were uniquely best placed with our powers and duties to undertake work. As I say, that was also part of the tailored review process. And then we kind of went out and consulted on, I think at that point it was 10 priority aims. And on the back of that consultation, we narrowed that down to 5.
Who you consult with and who your key stakeholders are?
We consulted very widely. I think we got over 1,000 responses to our consultation. So it's kind of, we were actually somewhat overwhelmed by that, and had to put more researchers onto the case. In terms of Scotland, do you want to?
Scotland, there was proportionally a lot of good responses from Scotland to our plan. We did a consultation period basically from the middle of the summer last year to December, and there was a general questionnaire that was out on our website for people to complete, and we had lots of responses to that, both organisationally and individually. We spoke individually to some of the key stakeholders we have in terms of protected characteristic organisations. We spoke to other key stakeholders, had meetings with government and other interested parties. We had 2 stakeholder events with ranges of organisations to test out our draft thoughts about what we might include in the plan. And as Alistair said, we used all of that to narrow down to the plan that we are currently taking forward.
And we did receive a disproportionately high response to the consultation from Scottish stakeholders as a GB organisation, which was great. And there was a kind of a very strong consensus on the ranking. We basically asked people to prioritise the 10 issues. The ones that we thought people would prioritise, they didn't. And it was interesting listening to the evidence earlier from the Scottish Human Rights Commission in relation to transport. Transport was an issue high on people's agenda. It wasn't something that we thought would be prioritised in our plan, but we are. We were committed to take a kind of honest approach to the consultation. We had kind of the notion of tech quite high up, as I think many organisations do. It wasn't high on the agenda. We had social security high up on our agenda, and it was low down. And I think people recognised that we weren't maybe best placed to be campaigning on increasing funding in social security, for instance, but were well placed to tackle issues like accessibility of transport, which is a major gateway for people to participate in life. So it was a really interesting exercise. In terms of technology, we are looking at that in every aspect, so we haven't dropped that kind of forward look. So for instance, in our work aim, there are some really interesting, potentially challenging issues around human rights, microchipping of individuals in the workplace, the use of algorithms in interviewing people to see if they're fit for a company. I know, we were surprised as well. The use of algorithms which identify if an individual is kind of fits an organisational culture, but then when you look at how algorithms are designed and who designs them, the inbuilt bias often of a gendered nature. So there's some really interesting stuff that we need to keep an eye on, and we've had an interest in gig economy for some time and taken some cases in that respect.
Thank you for that. Gail Ross.
Thank you, Convener. I'm still shocked. No, because I think we're reading the same book at the moment on algorithms and data gender bias and data gathering. But you said microchipping of individuals in the workplace. I really need you to expand on that sentence, please.
Do you have any of the details of that, Lynn? I'm kind of looking to you because you're nodding as well. It's something we have talked about, and I don't have the evidence to hand, but I can.
I think it's sort of to gather. Well, sometimes it will be to open doors easily. They will argue, you know, so it does that kind of stuff. So instead of having your little pass, you can just have a microchip. But it also lets employers know, in some instances, where you are at any time.
It's
not a but new concept. Yeah. I mean, I worked in the electronics industry back in the early 1980s in Scotland, and in those days, the company I worked for would chip your badge so that they could track you in terms of where you were. It was positioned as a sort of health and safety thing, but it was also used for other things, and then fell out of favour, I think, in terms of that. So.
I'm happy to send some of the background information we were looking at in terms of the priority aims.
Please do, and rest assured, I think, put our minds at rest that they're not actually implanting chips into people. And
seems they are.
They are.
I'm sure that actually is a case where somebody was.
Right, okay. Yeah, I think we would appreciate some more information on that in written form. That's really thrown my train of thought there now. You obviously were listening to the evidence that we took in the first session. What would you say is the biggest human rights issue, and obviously equalities issue, that we're facing in Scotland at the moment?
It's quite hard to identify one issue, to be honest. I mean, if you look at Is Scotland Fairer 2018, that shows the state of progress on a whole range of issues for a whole range of groups of people in life in Scotland today. And while there are some areas of progress, some aspects of gender equality, progress on issues like gender pay gap, at least reporting if not reducing the gap, there are a whole set of areas of life where there is not progress for some groups of people. Particularly, I think the evidence pointed to lone parents, disabled people, gypsy traveller communities. So I wouldn't say that there is one specific issue. I just think that the challenges for British society and Scottish society in a time of kind of ongoing austerity and in a time of kind of more divided communities, be that kind of politically or economically, there are significant challenges in terms of people's ability to participate equally in any aspect of life. And Is Scotland Fairer is not an easy read. I think you'll agree, and the kind of areas that we've identified to work on are those that we think we can have the most impact on. So for us, it's those five areas. It is about people getting fair access to work and being treated well in work. It is about people being able to participate in life through transport. And while we've identified disabled people in Scotland, rural aspects of transport are important. Again, the gendered nature of the way that transport runs. Education, and again, I think in terms of some of the evidence given earlier by the Scottish Human Rights Commission and the kind of public views of equality and human rights potentially becoming more disparate, we think the education system's got a key role. And previously we looked at kind of issues like bullying, which were quite specific, but we're actually more interested in the role of schools in building better societies. So we will be focusing our attention on things like who gets into school, who's kept in school, believing that contact with diversity improves people's understanding of difference rather than pulling apart. So the role of schools in terms of tackling what eventually becomes hate crime, to be honest. Access to justice remains a significant challenge and a significant issue, and I'm sure Lynn will be happy to say more about that, even though we have seen some significant improvements and interventions in Scotland, we are still concerned about people's ability to access justice and the justice system's ability to evidence that it is making improvements for different groups of people. So they're kind of the key areas of inequality rather than the big one, as it were.
Okay, thank you. Convener, I just want to explore one specific aspect of the evidence that we got, and that's the city deals, or city regional deals, as we should call them. Do you feel that the investment, welcome as it is, going into these areas, is it going into the rural areas as much as it should be?
Well, there are, I think, 15 city deal partnerships across Scotland at the moment. Our work over the last 2 years has basically been to work with the city deal partnerships to try and ensure that whatever it is that they're doing in their local areas, that they take fully into account the ability of these significant investments from the Scottish and UK governments over a long period of time to ensure that you can address some of the barriers that exist for different groups. So in employability terms, in terms of some of the projects that will go forward, are the city deal partnerships a way, clearly they are a way of addressing some of the long-standing issues around access for certain groups, women and employment in certain areas of technology, those sorts of things. In terms of building programmes, it's an opportunity to address some of the housing issue needs that our housing inquiry threw light on. So what we've done over the last 2 years is really try and work with the city deal partnerships, and we had some great support from COSLA, and we had some good engagement from city deal partnerships about using these as opportunities to address, I mean, it's up for each individual city deal partnership to address the issues they want to in their local area, but it's about ensuring that whatever it is they're doing, they're looking clearly at the equality and human rights aspects to those. Our work has finished in terms of that initial pilot phase, and our understanding is that the government, the minister, has committed to providing some resources to continue the work that we started. If that helps.
Just to say that we haven't, I mean, in direct answer to your question, we haven't been looking at the kind of rurality aspect of it. It has been much more about how you use procurement and investment to address the issues that are important to us. And it is a plank of our new public sector equality duty strategy that we think procurement could be used much more as we think positive action could be used much more to drive the sort of change that we want to, which kind of aligns to what I said earlier about kind of more compliance, more enforcement rather than just necessarily gentle hand holding.
Okay. And just finally, really quickly, Convener, if I can, you also heard the evidence from the Scottish Human Rights Commission that they would welcome added powers and added resources. Would that help you if they had more powers and resources?
Had more.
Yes.
Yes, because the arguments they make about additional powers and resources to further and promotion and progression of human rights in Scotland is absolutely aligned to our own I mean, we are, in comparison, fortunate with our resources, even though we've seen a cut of 70 million down to 17 million this year, which is why I say that we've had to make some tough choices. We are still far better resourced than the Scottish Human Rights Commission, given the mandate that they have. And people kind of think, well, you're kind of that proportionate size smaller, but in reality, we're dealing with the same issues across the same breadth of areas of life. And the SHRC are, they need adequately resourced and the adequate powers to help them achieve that, okay. I would say. Annie, we'd also like more money and powers, but that's a separate that's for a separate room.
Anyone else?
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. My question is just going to be the same as which I asked the SHRC this morning. So what has been the Commission's biggest successes and how do you measure that success?
It's very nice going second, I have to say. It's like, that's a good question. How would I answer that? So I'm happy to start that, and maybe my colleagues might want to say something about legal successes and kind of policy successes. But I think for us, and what you see in front of you in terms of our strategic plan, one of the successes for us as a Scottish part of a GB organisation is that we've got a strategic plan that is fit for purpose for three countries, and that properly reflects the devolved aspects of our role and remit. So that feels like a success, because that's not an easy thing to come by in a big GB organisation that's trying to respond to three very different countries' aspirations on equality and human rights. Is Scotland fairer is a big success, I think, because this time it sets out some key recommendations for action. It's a major thing. It's not just a report. It's a major driver and indicator and spotlight on the significant issues that governments should be worried about if they're worried about equality and human rights. The recommendations this time round say, if you want the picture to look differently in 3 years' time, here's what we think you need to do. And our strategic plan says, and here's what we're going to do to try and hold you to account to the ones that we think are most, well, our constituents feel they're the most important. I want to say 100% compliance and gender pay gap enforcement last year, and a new approach to shining the spotlight on non-compliance this year. And I say that because we were established as a statutory body to undertake high-level strategic cases. We weren't established to do kind of regulation and enforcement en masse. And gender pay gap reporting and enforcement was a real challenge to us. It links a little bit to the powers and tools, but we've had to use our investigation powers as the threat to ensure compliance with gender pay gap reporting. Now, our investigation powers have been used on things like the Met, on bullying, and we're currently using them on the BBC on equal pay. They're not designed to go after every country in the land who are party to those regulations. Yet we achieved 100% compliance, and that was through some kind of quite creative working and a lot of focused resource. So I would like to say 100% compliance and gender pay gap is a highlight. And I'd also say, with the backdrop of the budget cuts that we have faced over the last 10 years, that we have increased compliance, we've increased enforcement. As I said, we've got two inquiries running, a major investigation, more in the pipeline. And I think that we are kind of, that these are big, visible headline issues which kind of make people see who we are and the powers we have. I remember sitting here a couple of years ago, people saying, you know, you're not using your powers, you don't have teeth. Well, I think we're kind of showing them now in a kind of quite constrained time. The business plan that we've also shared sets out our success measures for all our work. We have an organisational theory of change which says, what's the aim we're trying to achieve? What are the intermediate changes? Because some of these are long-time, lifetime changes. And what are the success measures on the way? And so some of them are, they're actually quite specific. That we would expect to see changes in legislation. We would expect to see 100% compliance. We would expect to see, for instance, if we go down the route of ethnicity pay gap reporting, our recommendations around what would make that effective, which are not the same as gender pay gap reporting. So hopefully the success measures here, and they're quite high level, and we're developing these for Scotland separately, but they're good impact measures that we'll be able to report on. I don't know if John or Lynn want to add anything to the highlights. They were mine.
I suppose more Scotland specifically, we've always had 100% compliance with the PSD publication duties as well over the 4-6 year period that those have been in, which I think has sent a good message to organisations about what's expected of them. I mean, we think the duties could be improved, but we keep them on people's agenda and they know that we look to see whether they are complying or not. And some of our enforcement legal work in the last year, I think, has been really effective in seeing real change for individuals, which is obviously what we want to see, I suppose, on the ground. So if you look at the work that we've been doing along with Royal Bank of Scotland, where all of their mobile services across all of Britain will now be entirely accessible, that's a lot of people you're helping, if you like, through one relatively small piece of work. But these things have really wide implications. I think the same with our Section 23 agreement with Police Scotland and flexible working. It's always been, you know, it's difficult for an organisation like that to work flexibly. But when you work with them and get those kind of agreements in place, you're having a really wide effect on who can get into the police force and how they're treated there. So some of that work, I think, has been really excellent this year.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Do you want to add anything, John?
I suppose in terms of some of the other areas, I think Alistair mentioned in his own remarks about the housing inquiry. That was a GB-wide inquiry, but there was some very specific evidence and recommendations for Scotland because of the different context, and we made some recommendations to the Scottish Government and just received a response after some months, and some of the recommendations we've suggested are going to be taken forward. I think the headline one, one of the headline ones about setting a 10% target, the government felt that wasn't appropriate for them to do and do it other ways, which is obviously disappointing. I think maybe another quick example would be we did a piece of work last year looking at asylum seekers' right to health. That was, again, a piece of GB work. Now, that's a mixture of reserved and devolved matters. I think what it showed was that the situation in Scotland was much better in terms of access to healthcare because of the different policies here to England, where there's issues to do with charging and access and data transfer and all of those sort of things. But it did pick up in Scotland the fact that there was confusion around primary care providers and GPs about who had access. Some of that confusion, I think, came caused by the Home Office sometimes. And as a result of what we said, the government committed and hasn't, I think, now produced a new guidance for primary care GP providers to make that a lot clearer in the system.
So thank you very much, Convener. Thank you.
Okay, Oliver, you should come.
Thank you, Convener. Back in February 2017, when you previously gave evidence to the committee, there was a discussion around restructuring and the impact that was having on some staff. Are you able to give an update?
Yes, restructures are never easy, particularly in a time when you're kind of facing a kind of financial cut. And we went through a fairly major restructure to ensure we were fit for purpose for the future. We've got through that. We got through that not without some scrapes and bumps along the way, but we now have the operating model fully in place, and we have undertaken some refinements, in fact, since we were last here, which includes the establishment of a compliance and enforcement team and increased staffing. And essentially what we've been doing is our budgets are kind of quite restricted in terms of how much money we get, which is administrative, which means we've got much less choice over what we do with it, and programme funding, where we have more choice. So what we've done is taken some of our programme funding to increase our staffing in Scotland, Wales and at GB level. So yeah, I'd say that we are fully through that. All our staffing are in place in the new operating model. It's working effectively. And it's working much more effectively across GB. One of the key planks of this was identifying an executive director with responsibility for a third of the organisation and a country. So we all have to champion a country as well as our functions. So I thankfully cover Scotland, it's kind of handy, and the delivery of our business plan across GB. So I'm able to, at the highest level, ensure that we build a kind of nation focus in. So yeah, it was a difficult process. I think that we are in a much better place. Our recent staff survey showed that we're pretty much in line with civil service averages, which is not bad. A couple of years in, when 2 years ago we wouldn't have necessarily had that result.
And do you feel the structures you've now identified are fairly stable, even in light of potential changes around the decision of the UK to leave the EU, or sort of other challenges you face with?
Yes. Yeah, I think, I mean, that was the whole point. We were kind of trying to future-proof. The danger was, previously, we were quite siloed, in a way. Scotland wasn't necessarily as built into the fabric of how we worked across GB. That's been a kind of big bit of our work. A big bit of the strategic plan is ensuring that we've got aims that are fit for purpose for all of us. Historically, there might have been stuff about, for instance, over-representation of black and ethnic minority people in prisons. That's not an issue here, so therefore we would have kind of immediately been excluded from that activity. So I think both the aims that we're working on, which are fit for purpose for all countries, and an operating model, which is kind of networked, we're about to go into another spending review round, and who knows what we will face then. I mean, we kind of feel that we have trimmed, a bit like the Scottish Human Rights Commission, we have trimmed as far as we can in order to be effective. There are new expectations on the horizon for us on things like website accessibility, potentially ethnicity pay gap regulations. We will struggle if we have to put all our resources into that sort of activity, given our aspirations for kind of much bigger kind of compliance enforcement work, which we think will have the sort of impact that people want to see. Long answer to the short question is yes, we're fit for the future.
Thank you.
Can I ask some questions around the public sector equality duty? Lynn Welsh had mentioned that she felt that could be improved. I'm wanting a wee bit more detail on how it could, in your opinion, how it could be improved.
Will I start? We did a review ourselves of the duty last year, both at a sort of general duty, sort of GB kind of level, as well as how the specific duties were working in Scotland, and we're left with a number of concerns, I guess, out of the end of that. I think the outcome focus for the duties was absolutely the right one, but it doesn't seem to have been effective. Authorities don't seem to be able to understand how to set an outcome that they can measure, that is actually aimed at individual protected characteristics. They tend to be, we will train staff, we will help everybody, rather than we will help the black and ethnic minority group that we have, whatever. So they're too wide, they're too homogenous, and they're not, you can't actually see the outcomes that are supposed to be achieved. So although outcomes sound like the right idea, in practice we're not seeing that as being effective. And so we were potentially looking towards the government taking more of a lead role in setting the kind of outcomes itself that it would want to see for Scotland, which may then allow to lead, basically, and show other authorities where the areas are that where there's the worst inequalities in health or in local government effective areas. Those were the sort of main issues. We also have issues around stuff like the employment reporting. What the different protected characteristics that you are recruiting, retaining, developing. Authorities for some reason seem to find this incredibly difficult to do. You would think fairly basic kind of information crunching, but the information doesn't seem to be there, so there's something fundamentally problematic about how that particular duty is working as well. The equality impact assessments, in principle, a great idea. Look at what the effect that your policies, your practices are having. I think there's always a danger that becomes more tick box than outcome focused, and perhaps that needs to have a bit of thought about how that gets developed and how it can be regulated.
And the thing, if I may, the role of regulators, inspectorates and ombudsmen as well, who are inspecting public bodies, strengthening the link for them in terms of their responsibilities when they're doing that, to look at how public bodies are faring against the public sector equality duties.
would be another one, I think.
Yeah. And also to add, I mean, when we look at equality outcomes set by public authorities, there are thousands of them, if not tens of thousands of them, and they're all disparate. They don't add together to achieve impact in any single area because they're up to individual authorities to set. And that makes it also impossible to monitor progress against. And so in terms of our role, they are, you know, it's a very difficult set of duties. The due regard duty is also kind of very general and very difficult to enforce in any meaningful way. So I'll go back to Is Scotland Fairer? It sets out the significant inequalities in life. And if they were set as the areas in which we would be undertaking public sector equality duty work, that we would tackle the gender pay gap, that we would tackle disabled people's access to employment, that we would tackle any of the issues, and that we or that public authorities were required to set out what they would do to achieve that goal, we think that would be a much more effective mechanism. It would allow us to look specifically at the experience of different protected characteristics rather than this tens of thousands to try and identify what will any of this do for anyone. And unlike human rights, you know, we don't have to fight to gain an understanding of why equality is important or what the kind of equality framework looks like. People generally get it, but the slight danger is that it's become an industry. And I have sat in meetings where someone's pushed over box files of proudly their equality impact assessments and pushing them aside. It's like, tell me one thing that's changed as a result of that. And the bead of sweat appeared in the brow. And I mean, it's just like, why are we doing this? Why? So our view is, when we look at reviewing the public sector equality duty and looking at the future of incorporation of human rights and thinking about how we make that a practical, realised aspect of decision-making within public authorities, let's not just bolt on more on something that we don't think is working particularly well. Let's kind of take a fresh look.
And on the other side of that boxload coin are issues where there are big major strategies and policies which haven't had any equality impact assessment, which we've had to follow up with certain public authorities about when it's been drawn to our attention. So there's a whole mixed bag of stuff in there.
There's been some criticism of your own role and your power to ensure compliance by public authorities. You're talking about the issues and the problems about how you get public authorities to work with their duties. Is that why maybe people are criticising your own role about ensuring compliance? Is it very difficult to do that? What do we need to change to make sure, one, that the duty works, and two, that your role in ensuring compliance works as well?
Yeah. So it is that breadth piece. I mean, we have looked at how we monitor, let alone enforce, and have struggled to do that. It's almost felt like bean counting over the years, and it makes it quite difficult to identify specific areas where we might take action, though we have taken action over the years. But in terms of our new strategic plan and our new approach to the public sector equality duty, we will focus specifically on the duty across our aims. So rather than trying to look at compliance across all public authorities, what we'll be doing is saying, take the transport aim, look at the role of public authorities in providing accessible transport, and use every lever at our disposal to achieve change. So the public sector equality duty is built into each of our five big aims. It picks up on John's point, what's the role of regulators, inspectors and other agencies in overseeing the delivery of those plans, holding them to account in terms of their public sector equality duty. So it'll be a much more focused, targeted approach. And it will be, as well as this kind of focus on compliance and enforcement, we are communicating much more widely and loudly about these cases. In the past, we were kind of more likely not to publicise when we were taking action in the hope that that would encourage people to do the right thing. We are more likely to publicise because I think that lets people know this is regulated space. And what sits under that, as I've also said, is kind of taking on each of these aims, as many kind of legal cases as we can. We'll be kind of going out actively, advice clinics, going out actively to communities saying we are looking for cases on transport. We want to know if people have experienced discrimination have not been able to access the transport system. We want to take as many cases as we can. We want to hold regulators and inspectors to account. We want to focus on the strategies that set the national transport strategies. It's that kind of combined use of our levers and powers that we think will achieve change and will show people that we can use the public sector equality duty effectively.
I mean, I think it's true also that we do, and it just might not be evident. I mean, there is no piece of work that we would do that relates to the public sector where we would not be asking PSD questions, ever. So if we had some concern about anything that those organisations would do, our first question is, where's your EIA of that? Shows that you had an outcome relating to that. You know what I mean? So it's built in intrinsically into a lot of what we do. But it does take a lot of resource to directly enforce it. So we have been enforcing over the years the publication of it. That takes a ridiculous amount of man hours to do, and there are 250 odd public authorities, so there is something that about the strategic nature of where it is that we would point. And as Alistair says, going forward, we very much are looking at regulators who we don't believe necessarily are doing their own equality duty and are not regulating the duty when they're going into the organisations that they see, and also looking at the areas where the strategic plan is biting and using our PSD powers more in relation to those areas.
You've provided us with some examples of cases that you've supported. I wonder if you just maybe want to talk a little bit more about those, and be interested to know if you're seeing an increase at all in the number of potential cases. It sounds from what Alistair said there that you're actually going to proactively go out and get more, but just if you want to speak a little more on that.
We are, and we did that last year. Also, we ran a specialist project for education cases and then broadened that out to services cases. And that gave us a good bit of learning, I think, about how better to try to find those cases. I mean, the bottom line is, in Scotland, there's maybe only been about 25, 30 cases, service cases, taken ever in 10 years. So it is ridiculously tiny. Employment cases there are, education cases there are, a few more coming through, but basic service provision cases are rarely in court. And there are a lot of reasons for that, sadly, one of them not being that there is no discrimination in services. there are a variety of reasons. People are not particularly litigious in Scotland, strangely enough, and the kind of issues that have to come out in discrimination cases, for example, speaking about your disability or similar, is very difficult, or outing yourself as gay, or you know, those kind of issues also play into that. And so we're going to do a really targeted bit of work around transport to start with, and then probably again education and reasonable adjustments and exclusions in that area, to see, we are here and we will offer you that support, and we'll be actively going around Scotland, especially up North Highlands, for the transport stuff, because there are very particular sort of double whammies, as you were speaking about previously, in relation to that, to try to build people's understanding of what their rights are, which is fundamental. It actually is something that they can do about these things, and then make clear that we're offering that kind of direct support for them. So we still don't see as many individual cases, if you like, as we might want to, where we can actually help individuals. But I think our enforcement work more broadly, where we're using our own powers, we are doing more of that, and I think we're being more effective about it. And I say a bit of that will be in our annual report coming. The work with Royal Bank of Scotland, the work with Police Scotland, the work, the case we had in relation to Kilmarnock Football Club. So we spread the learning from all of that. So it's not just one case and one individual that gets help, but you try to then expand out to contacting others and saying, do you know this is what happens when you don't comply with some of this work? And we're using our judicial review power, because we do have a power to take judicial reviews in our own name where we think authorities are breaching either equality or human rights. And we're looking to do a bit more of that, because that then takes the pressure off individuals having to claim a sort of discrimination if we can look at it more strategically. And so we have one running at the moment, and we're hoping to have more of those going forward in next year as well.
Okay, thank you. Fulton.
Thanks, Convener. I had a couple of questions, but I think actually the detail and the responses is actually covered a lot of it already. But one of the things that we heard quite a lot about was how difficult it can be for folk to access justice, and you were just talking about that both there and a wee bit earlier. And I wonder if you could expand a wee bit more on the legal support project that you've got going just now.
That idea of going out and saying to people, we will do transport cases, particularly at the moment, but we will give you advice and we will give you support. And so there'll be two or three staff actually who are going to be focusing on that quite strongly for the next little while. Building people's knowledge, going out to disability organisations, for example, local ones, and explaining what people's rights are in relation to transport or discrimination more generally. And we're also doing at the moment a little bit of research into legal aid that's available. We want to make sure that those who have discrimination claims are not being stymied by the fact that they can't fund them. And so we're working with the Legal Aid Board just now to look at some of the figures that they have about who's applying for legal aid, how often they get it, around sort of discrimination issues. I think part of the problem is that there's not enough data being collected. We're not sure how much information the Legal Aid Board has, for example. Certainly the courts don't also seem to be looking at who is using those courts and what kind of cases are getting brought there. So a lot of the information we have is fairly apocryphal. We are supposed to be told when a discrimination case is raised, which is where we get our figures from, but we're not absolutely certain that those are every case that is there. So I think there's a bit of work being done by our research colleagues to sort of say you as organisations have to start gathering that information. Because to be blunt, how are you meeting your equality impact, your equality duties, if you've no idea who you're serving at all? I think there's a real fundamental issue there as well that will longer term help the access to justice aim. But yes, the biggest thing for us in the short term going forward is to say to people, we are here to support your individual issues.
Is that something that, that the SHRC are involved in with you as well, given the potential overlap of
Not directly in that project, because it's mainly going to be about quality cases, but absolutely they're reaching out to those same sort of organisations and areas of interest. It may well have a lot of good synergy that we can certainly look at. That would be helpful.
I mean, it's probably just worth reiterating that that we're not going out taking every case in every area, and going back to the fact that we're funded and we're set up to be strategic. So the sorts of cases that Lynn's referenced already, RBS and Police Scotland, are ones where we think we can have greater impact, or where we're going to test out the law. And the legal aid projects are specific to our aims, so they're a way of kind of building up that body of evidence and really shining a spotlight on what's regulated.
Okay, well, that brings us to an end of this session. Thank you very much for your evidence. The committee has already agreed to consider evidence in private, so I'll now move into private session and ask the public gallery to clear. Our next meeting will be on the 30th of May, and details will be published on our website in advance.